Hello and welcome back to Scale Me Down and to the launch of a brand new project, this VQ Models de Havilland Twin Otter. Please like and subscribe to support the channel. Let's get the box open and see what we've got.
It was all well packed with all the parts in individual bags, and it's a balsa and ply construction with pre-printed covering, with this colourful scheme being a scale rendition of a Costa Rican operator. We're going to use the electric power it's designed for, although I guess you could use a couple of 25 glow engines. The quality of the parts, the pre-printed covering, and the fiberglass mouldings seem to be of really good quality. This is going to replace my elderly de Havilland Beaver on both floats and wheels. The build starts with the motor nacelles, which the instructions suggest should be glued with thin CA, but I elected to use slow epoxy and then clamped both firewalls to a board to ensure alignment. And then while we have the epoxy mixed, let's make some little adapter plates for the aileron servos. The supplied incidence dowels didn't fit very well, so I cleaned out the holes with a 6mm drill bit and then fitted some carbon tube with epoxy after roughening on a permagrit block. The provided pull-through strings make fitting the aileron and flap servos dead easy. Horns simply glue into preformed holes in the control surfaces after first removing a little bit of covering. The supplied linkages all seem fit for purpose. Next, the instructions get you to mount the motors using the supplied long M3 bolts from behind the firewall, but I think this will make access difficult in the future. Instead, let's draw some spacers and cut them out from plywood on our laser. I glued several of these together to make up the required thickness. I then substituted long cap head screws into captive nuts mounted behind the firewall. As I tightened the motors up, the captive nuts sank their claws into the firewalls. I've chosen these reversing speed controllers from Hobbywing. In addition to the usual three motor wires and two battery wires, there are these two servo wires. This one for the throttle, whilst this one enables reverse thrust. And the shorter lead is for programming the ESC. Of course, VQ Models makes no provision for the ESC wiring. So here I've tied a nut to a long piece of string and dangled it through a hole I drilled in the wing to pull the wires through. And here are the wing routes with the battery wires and servo wires.
So, with the wings tackled, the instructions get us to move on to the fuselage, starting with the fitment of the landing gear. And that makes a lot of sense so that we don't mark or mar this lovely pre-printed covering. The main landing gear looks absolutely fine, but I think we can do a little bit better than this pre-supplied nose leg. After all, we need to make it easily removable for fitment of the floats. So let's see what we can do.
Firstly, the main landing gear legs would have gone on just fine. However, the captive nuts in the fuselage were full of glue and paint from the factory. So first I had to clean them out with an M3 tap. And while I was at it, I cleaned out the threads of all the captive nuts on the airframe with this tap in the same way. Then we can refit the belly fairing with these little thumb screws from inside the fuselage. And then fit the leg fairings with little self-tapping screws, although I might revisit these with some silicone for security later. I also had to open out the holes for the axle bolts. This was all ARTF fare and straightforward, but for the nose leg I wanted something more scale, so I drew up this nose fork for 3D printing in PLA Plus. For the rest of the nose leg, I used some bits and bobs I had lying around in my workshop, including a collet, some brass tubing and a spring. I drilled and soldered the parts to come up with something like this. And when I come to fit the floats, I can remove the nose leg by slackening this one grub screw without removing the nose cone. Now we can move on to the tail. Here I'm removing a bit of the pre-printed covering, which is quite thick and self-adhesive, and quite unlike the heat shrink film found on many ARTF planes. The key to this is to fit a brand new blade into your knife. I've protected the covering with some low-tack masking tape, as the instructions warn about cleaning up excess epoxy with alcohol, probably to avoid wiping the printing off. Then I'm checking that it's nice and square to the fin. When we epoxy the tail assembly into the slot in the rear fuselage, VQ Models supply these two laser-cut corrugated cardboard templates to ensure that the tailplane incident is correct and that everything remains nice and square. This is a really nice touch. It's much easier to fit these horns now along with the backing plates before the surfaces are fastened in place. A smear of Vaseline on the hinge line and a bit of care stop this thin CA making a real mess. I made these little finlets for the floats installation, as it's much easier to do now. Servo installation's dead straightforward. The only thing that's a bit different is the double elevator pushrod, and it's just important to file flats on the piano wire here. There's quite a lot going on in the wings with these four servo wires each side, so we need to do something with the wiring so it's not a pain every time we take this plane out. I've elected to connect the servos with these green multiplex connectors, grouping together the red and black wires, and then the four remaining pins will be the servo signal wires. This all sounds dead neat, but the wiring harness is a real mess until it's installed. If you think that's bad, the power connections to the wings are even worse. We'll use these XT60s and an EC5 to connect to the battery, and as we've lengthened the wires to the speed controllers, we need to add these capacitors. We'll need a further feed for the BEC to power the radio gear, and the sensor wires for the telemetry for pack voltage. Much neater, and only two plugs per side at the field, which should be impossible to mix up. To achieve the required centre of gravity, the 4-cell 4000mAh battery pack will have to go right out here in the nose cone. So once again, I've designed some parts to cut on our laser to make a support tray. These were glued together with epoxy, sealed and then painted. I used some little tacks of CA to hold it all whilst the glue set, but the tray was glued in with epoxy. I taped card pointers to indicate the centre of the blocks. After drilling pilot holes for the screws, I remove the nose and open the holes out with a bigger drill. A bit of soap helps the screws go in. All that's left to do now is program the speed controllers, a final weight and balance, and fit the propellers. Turn inboards like this so that if one motor seizes, the torque is helping us rather than fighting us.
And that's about all we have time for in this episode. And we're now at a stage where she will fly. So join us in episode 2 of this VQ Models de Havilland Twin Otter build and review, where we'll conduct the maiden flight, we'll fit other features such as the struts, the cowlings, and the spinners, and other scale features. Until then, thanks for watching.